Welcome to the very awesome subject of testing. Okay. usually testing is kind of a boring subject, but I have to admit that I like this tool so much that I'm going to rave about testing as far as one can actually rave about testing. So, okay. This is about how to test your database with PGTub. And I'm going to talk a little bit about testing databases, about basic existence tests, give a little bit overview about what PGTub actually has to offer. Then I'm showing a little bit how to test your stored procedures and database functions, how to test queries, and what Cherry's PGTub on top of all this has to offer. So, testing, we are doing it, right? On every layer of the stuff. You're testing your graphical user interfaces. For example, in browser with the Selenium or Phantom.js, we test our middleware stuff with whatever we have, whatever we are using. And does anybody really test down below in the trenches, on the trenches of your database? So, there are two other tools, older tools, called Epic and PG Unit to test specifically on Postgres. But usually you test your database like this. You usually have, these days at least in web applications, for example, some ORM in play in whatever language you're using. There's a broad variety and you have a ton of choices usually. Or you didn't even have an ORM because they didn't exist yet, and then you use whatever has been there. It might not even be in a modern language. And let me remind you that Postgres in particular is actually rather old, so it really dates back a couple of years. So you have a lot of options in a lot of languages, and usually all testing of these kinds is of course tied to the language. So you test your stuff with Ruby in Ruby testing style on the thing you're using in Ruby to connect to your database. So the interesting part is, what if you could test your database totally alone, not tied to a specific programming language, independent of any database interface or ORM you're using on top, just run the test with nothing else required but the database and the test tool preferably. And what about your test strategy? Does it somehow even matter that you actually have, when you're not tied to a programming language, is it suddenly important how you are testing? Is it still important which testing strategy you're preferring with your database? For example, do you have a copy of very, very dirty and muddled customer databases, which are a decade old? Do you prefer the scenario that you actually set up everything on an empty database, run your tests, and then you tear it all down again? What kind of test do you really like? So, and that is the interesting part. What you can do with PGTub, it is, for those people who are familiar with Perl, it is basically test more for databases. You install this as a Postgres extension, and then you write tests. And if you add a little tool, you get a tub, you get a tub emitter, which works in all of your continuous integration and continuous deployment tools like Jenkins and so on and so on. It also exists for MySQL, but I'm using Postgres for all my stuff, so this is a little bit more focused on Postgres. It's written by a guy who is very skillfully in terms of Postgres and in terms of writing tools in general. And just as a side note, if you're interested in database change management, try his tool Squitch. It's tied to JIT, So if you're not using JIT, it might get difficult, but this is if you're changing your databases a lot, then this might be actually interesting for you as well. So how would you install pgtab? It's a regular Postgres extension. You simply make configure, make install, check, make install. Then you really just type create extension pgtab. So that is basically it, what you have to do, and it's tied to a database. So this is once you created the extension, and if you have more than one database, you of course need to do it on all of them. So let me remind you what is actually in your database, what you usually have. You have, of course, databases, the schemas of the databases, a ton of configuration on your databases. You have usually roles and groups and all this access stuff. You have, of course, tables and columns, lots and lots of them. You have types and checks and constraints. You have indexes and sequences. And then you're, of course, actually doing stuff with your data. Usually, you have views, triggers, stored procedures, functions, selects, inserts, updates, deletes, alters, and these kinds of things. So that is usually what your database consists of in the end and what you're doing with it. Of course, everybody has a different emphasis. So in many smaller companies, you configure this thing once, and then you don't look at it for the next, I don't know, decade. In companies which have a lot, lots and lots of databases and which are spreading things out, there, of course, configuration things are much more relevant. If you have, for example, interfaces to your database one way or another, a lot of companies have regular users on their SQL databases, which are supposed to do queries, then you might have more interesting access configurations, which you maybe don't have as if you're using your database as a web backend. So whatever you have, this is all testable with Postgres. And I created for this talk, it's all in my GitHub, of course, super advanced cat picture database as usual. And which I'm going to test. So, okay. I have the database, kitty cats. I have it already. So, and then I make my tables usually. Then I fill it with example data in this case, and then I run my tests. So, lovely, as we can see, lots and lots of tests are failing. So this is the output you're getting from pgtab with the tool pgproof. And this is the tab emitted output you can shove into BuildBot, Jenkins, and whatever you are using. And then in that case, you of course get red and not a green button. So, but now we have a database where we actually have stuff in it. So we have a cats database and we have a traits database of the cats. And there we have our kitties in it. And there we have a description of our cat. So we have a couple of columns and a couple of tables, and of course it's a lot more. Imagine this is hundreds and hundreds of cat tables, of course. So what you're going to do is now, if you're starting with database testing, you have to start somewhere. And my recommendation is usually to start somewhere very simple and very seemingly stupid and maybe not so overly useful for you. So after you created your new tables, you can actually check if you actually have your tables. All pgtab tests look like this. You begin, you do, you call the testing functions, and then you roll it all back. So whatever you are doing within the database moves away at the end. So, okay, I'm testing here for the existence of the table cats, for the existence of the table traits, and I'm testing if the tables are in the Postgres schema public, and if this schema actually has those tables. And then I'm finished with the tests, and I've run three tests, and then I hopefully get everything in green. So if you're testing basic testing in pgptub, of course, can be simple tests for existence. If you just started adding new tables, for example, or shoving around columns, then existence tests after refactoring are, of course, your friend. So you check if it has the table cats, if the cats table actually has a primary key, if it has an index, if it has checks, and if the cats table actually has the column ID, for example. Yes. That's not fancy syntax, that's just me, sorry. So you can also test for more things which should actually exist in your database. For example, does it have a sequence with the type of sequences is serial, for example? Does it has the function nicerH I've written specifically for this database? Does it have a trigger on the traits table on the updated column? Does it have an index actually? And does it, for example, have the access role cat sitter? So you already have like almost 15 tests, which are simply checking if you actually have all your stuff and all your things on your database, and you simply go on and on with this. And you can really test a lot of things for existence. So some things are more Postgres-y niche-y stuff, and some things are, of course, rather common. So for example, has a specific user, has specific functions, has specific roles, has a primary key, has a foreign key, for example. If all your columns are really there, and these kinds of things. If you have the views you are expecting on this particular database. So this is the variety where you can test for existence of your stuff. So sometimes you want to do the other way around, that you test actually for things which basically shouldn't exist. After you removed, for example, you did some refactoring and removed certain roles, triggers, and these kinds of things. So you usually also have the opposite of existence, which basically tests for that this thing shouldn't be there anymore. So, okay, of course you don't want to write hasn't a million times. So you can, for example, use the plural tests, so to speak. This tests if the database, if the table cats has the columns ID, picture, breed, origin, and birthday, and exactly this, and nothing more. So if there is another column on it, the test would, for example, fail. If there is, of course, a column missing, it would fail equally. This is usually a little bit shorter, but it gets very visually cluttered if you have old tables which have like this, 80 columns or something, then of course it looks horrible. It's sometimes a little bit simple. You can spread it out, of course, so you can test for if you actually would have 80 columns on a table, then you basically can also loop over these kinds of things. Also, it depends a little bit how much tab output you really want. If you want this very fine-grained, then it's of course more useful to check for every single column if you want to have it. Because you can add a comment, for example, so you get a lot of information in addition to this. So then those are basically the tests which test for both varieties, that you actually have exactly this and not more and not less. So, and you also have a variety of these things. So, okay. If you would, for example, want to test your configuration stuff, you have a range of seemingly too simple, too stupid testing functions, which are called okay, is, isn't, matches, doesn't match, alike, unalike, compare, okay, and so on and so on. And those are extremely practical to test, for example, configuration settings. I mean, you can reach almost anything and everything from within Postgres about your Postgres. You can, of course, select all kinds of configuration stuff and all kinds about the system tables and all kinds about, I don't know, the size of your tables and the size of your database and whatnot. And these kinds of things are usually quite nicely to be tested with these really, really simple things, because what do you really want to know, for example, about a configuration setting? You want to know if you have it and if it has the proper value. And as you, for example, can change configuration settings on the fly from within a running Postgres with Postgres 9.4, you can now change configuration, run your tests, and basically see if actually everything is fine without restarting all the stuff. So, if you actually have everything in your database, and this is, for example, for people who are basically not doing a lot of selects and are maybe a little bit more on the DBA part, they might be done by now. Then you can move on to a more developer-oriented stuff that you actually can check a little bit more for your columns and what your columns really entail. So does the CATS database actually have the column birthday? Is the column set to be not null? Does it have a default? So if my cat is born and I insert a cat, it gets automatically a birthday. Does it have a default for this, for example? When I add a newborn cat, I simply declare it's from today, of course. And is the column type the proper type, for example? And then does it have, for example, does the CATS database, does it have a check on the column origin? I'm only allowing the typical two-letter country code, and if I would input, for example, more than two letters, three letters or anything, then the constraint should, of course, fail. And I can test that if this check is actually there. So these kinds of testing is that you check about your types, constraints, nulls, and defaults of your columns. And you can practice this as excessively as you would really like. So that can, I mean, I'm on one column in one table. So imagine this a little bit more extensively. So, okay, you can, of course, then test even more on columns. For example, if your tables and columns relate properly to each other. So for example, okay, you have the table cats. The cats table has a primary key. The cats table has a column called ID. And this column is actually the primary key of this table. So it also has a table traits. The table traits has a foreign key. And it also has a column cat ID, and the column cat ID is a foreign key. And then you're testing here the relation between traits and cats and the cat ID column to the ID column. This is the last test, the FK OK. This is in particularly interesting because it makes sure that both sides of the relation are existing and are relating properly to each other. This might be, if you have relatively complex relations, this actually might be the most interesting test for you. Also, you already see that it really is your business how you organize your tests. So basically, would you like to group all configurations together for all tables? Or are you going to write basically a rather extensive test list for one specific table? That's totally up to you. Or would you like, if we are later getting to things like queries and all these relations, would you like to actually test more workflow related? That, for example, you start testing your typical user table and their ID, and then you insert stuff, and then you check if you inserted it properly and the proper things, and then you test if you can actually properly remove it, and so on and so on. So basically, you can test the entire process of managing a user, which also makes totally sense for specific scenarios, but this is really completely up to you. So you, of course, can test all kinds of triggers. So for example, do you actually have the function myTimestamp? Is the function myTimestamp written in PLPG SQL? If you maybe remember that Postgres, of course, supports lots and lots of languages, and a lot of people use, for example, Python in Postgres, Perl in Postgres. You can use Node.js in Postgres. There's R bindings for Postgres and whatnot. So you can write all kinds of things and actually test if this is the proper language for this function. Then you can see if the function actually returns the right stuff, and if it sits on the right stuff. Because my timestamp is supposed to be on the updated column in the traits table. You can test this as well, so that you don't mix up your stuff. This is interesting for people who are writing lots and lots of functions by themselves and have lots and lots of stores procedures. You check if you actually have your important function nicerH for MyKitty, and then you actually test if this function actually, for example, returns the proper stuff you're expecting from it. So I'm calling this function on cat's birthday, and I wrote the function so it would return nicer month and nicer days and these kinds of things. And then I'm testing if this would actually return the nicer age string for this kitty. So the test, for example, is something okay, tests for the return type of your function. And then you can also simply test if the function returns the type you're expecting. So this usually goes all together, that you are testing if it if your function exists, if it returns the proper thing you are expecting, and if it actually returns the proper type you are expecting from this database. So, okay, if you don't care for this stuff at all, you're mostly simply doing queries, then you can, of course, test your queries. And there you would, for example, test if this insert actually successfully works. So you're doing the insert, and then you're expecting that this should be simply okay. And you can, of course, test this as extensively and as complicated as you would like. So you also, of course, sometimes want to know if something fails. I mean, you're usually having a lot of constraints, possibly, on your columns. So this is basically the other way around, that you are asking, is my column actually rejecting things properly? So you can test for throws, okay. And this test, of course, is a database failure, but the test, of course, is okay, because that's exactly what it's supposed to do. So if you would, for example, test for basic select stuff and actually see if you really get the stuff you want from your database, then you can, of course, test that as well. So in this regard, you test if you actually get your kitty of a specific breed and so on and so on. And the select tests are a little bit more interesting because you can vary if you want to also have a specific order tested. If you care or not care for duplicates in your results, or if you just want to see if something is actually in there somewhere. So you can vary this a little bit. You can make it either more precise or a little bit less precise to basically it's a variety that you just grab into your results and see if it's there and everything else is okay. So this is a little bit more specific on the select statements that you actually can not care for the order and for duplicates, that that duplicates are really okay and the order doesn't matter. That is basically the most unspecific test. And then, of course, you also can test for stuff which shouldn't be there. So if you removed something after refactoring and so on and so on, or if you deleted something in a query, then of course you expect certain things to simply have been gone. So then you of course can test a ton of owners, grants, and permissions. Postgres allows really rather fine-grained and rather sophisticated stuff. Many people don't need it in a very fine-grained thing, but if you would actually have that, and if it actually really gets complicated, then you have, of course, the whole shebang to test this entire thing. So, and then you, of course, have some helper methods. For example, if you would like to skip tests, if tests isn't quite done, if you simply want to do a little bit output, if you need the pgtab version, the Postgres version, and these, it's really just a random collection of maybe useful or not so useful things to you. So, and in the end, you can, of course, write your own test functions if you would like. This entire thing, pgtab, is in PLSQL, and David Wheeler basically has also added a little bit of API to it, so you can extend and enhance the testing functions itself and add new testing functions which you might need, which aren't covered by the basic range which is available in this case. And so that is a simple overview, and most people already know this, but this is how cat pictures really get into your database. So yes, that is a short overview. Any questions about this? Yes.
So I was thinking about the beginning of your presentation, the existence tests.
Yes.
So if I were to write a database schema and then write an existence test for all of this, it seems like a little bit of a duplicated effort. So do you think it's possible or feasible to have tests generated from the schema or the other way around, or perhaps both from a common notation?
I'm a little bit torn apart between whether or not it is a good idea to actually generate tests, because if you think a little bit about it, tests are basically to make sure that you write some code which actually checks on things you've already written. If you generate tests, then strictly speaking, you would actually have to test the generation of the tests. And then, of course, it gets... And so I'm always not quite sure.
Right, but
I probably would generate basic tests if I would have, 200 tables and 500 columns and whatnot, right. Then I'm not going to type
what
it.
What I'm thinking is that under the assumption that what I created is definitely right because this is what I created, but I want it to be future proof. So I want to be sure that I didn't break it in the future. So in this case,
yes.
Under the assumption that the initial code is correct, right?
Yes, but let me remind you, I mean, there is, of course, these days a lot of folklore about testing best practices. And you are actually supposed to also refactor your tests. Imagine that my CAT database is over a decade old. Am I really going to test after a decade still if the database is actually there and if the CATS table is really available and so on and so on? So you're actually supposed to remove tests at a certain point. Or you simply write a smarter strategy that you basically, you could also reorder your tests. And you can, of course, focus on specific areas of testing. I mean, the Postgres we are using in the office doesn't have a sophisticated configuration. So this is, I don't know, 2 dozen tests at most, which are not even really important because that will never change. Maybe every, I don't know, every couple of new versions when there is something really, really interesting or something changed, then we would actually change the configuration. So that's really not the most important part of testing. These kinds of things. We have a couple of functions and stored procedures, but we are not very intense on this. So that will only be a couple of tests. So it's mostly queries and these kinds of things. And really, really, this is totally up to you how you organize this and on what part you're really focusing. I mean, most very few databases make use of all of it equally. So,
I have a question myself, actually.
Okay.
It relates to the previous question also. Some tests are nice for day-to-day test-driven development, while some tests are nice for making sure you don't break decade-old functionality when you change stuff. So ideally, I would test for behavior and not so much of specifics of implementation in the long run. While on a day-to-day basis, you might actually also want to test for small specifics of implementation. So in some sense, I suppose, it could be nice to generate, just dump out tests assuming the current schema is complete. You might actually need it because you are going to do some fun and new interesting stuff that particular day.
Yeah, well, the interesting part about Postgres in particular is that you can change a lot of things in Postgres on the fly while the entire thing is running. Not many people really do that extensively. And I hear by some questions that the assumption is that you won't touch certain areas of your database basically ever again. So you just need your basic tests and that's it. And yes, I would probably generate those tests as well and focus on the stuff which is really constantly changing and gets constantly moved around. But let me remind you that this is actually a really hard problem where most companies have their own homemade strategy to deal with it. You're adding a new feature. And of course, it's a no-brainer to deal with it in the middleware and in the user, a no-brainer, to deal with it in your middleware code and in the user interface where you are used to refactoring and already know how to change things and how to map this into your versioning and how to do a nice commit and these kinds of things. When it comes to databases, this typical database change stuff where you add a column or you move a column around or give a column a new type and these kinds of things, this is suddenly where everybody sits with his own script at home one way or another, and then you suddenly invent a versioning numbering scheme where the scripts have to run in a specific order and so on and so on. And that is usually the horrible scenario which you usually have when you are dealing with databases. And that is usually where you actually should write your tests for, of course. But this is really these kinds of database change management, which I mentioned at the beginning, that is rather at the beginning in terms of tool chains and tooling. And it's really rather complicated. And I ask around a little bit with friends in bigger companies, and almost everybody has his homegrown, homemade, partially over a decade old thing to somehow do this. So, and that is of course where I would throw lots and lots of tests on it. You can also test, for example, there's a little pseudo benchmarking test that you can actually test if a certain query doesn't take longer than so and so. And this is, for example, this gets interesting when you're testing on a growing database with existing data. I worked, for example, for a company which had customer databases as a copy to actually see specific bugs and specific needs really directly. And you could, of course, test these kinds of databases as well. I mean, I can't really stress this enough that, of course, most people think, oh yes, testing, and I have a nice schema, and everything is pretty, and I have really well-designed databases, and it's, of course, totally normalized and then denormalized to make it more real. I mean, most databases are absolutely horrible in their design, realistically speaking. And this is really where you suddenly have a tool where you can take your existing 15-year-old horrible database with all its crap in it and all its bugs and everything, and start writing tests that you actually can start moving things around possibly. So this is basically what this tool really allows you. Of course, it's a no-brainer if you're starting new to write pretty tests and to generate pretty tests and everything, but that's usually not the realistic scenario you're usually having. Or you're having this once and then never again, because then it grows. Yeah, but I can really highly recommend the tool. In general, it's extremely well written, very smooth to use. It's nicely documented, and it's very easy to get into. That is actually the nice part, in my opinion. So there is no reason to learn some elaborate test concept. You start with something totally stupid and something totally simple. Really check if all your tables are there and go from there. And then you can start with the more useful tests. I also put basically a PGTab primer in my GitHub. Do I actually have? Oh. What was it? Yeah, but the not so secret key is encrypted. Ah, yes, and I think I. Okay, no, it doesn't work anymore. It worked. Anyways, you find it in my GitHub, and it's simply a set of all the basic kinds of things you can move your tests around, where you can actually see the tests and actually play with it, because you usually... This is how it, in the end, really looks. For you, for example, that you have all kinds of ranges of tests. And you might have I'm in the office, I'm somewhere a little bit over 500 tests at the moment. But I'm slowly getting to the point where it makes a lot more use to actually throw most of the table tests out or shorten them to something else. But this is how it looks, and the only inconvenient thing is, of course, Postgres is very, very specific with its types, and if you're comparing things, then you, of course, have to be very exact with the type. And for example, is it timestamp with a time zone with a space in between? Is it timestamp without time zone and so on and so on? So that's a little bit of typing work, and there would generating things, of course, be easier. You might possibly even be able to have templates for your test generation. That, of course, works as well. Okay, any more questions? Okay, then enjoy a little bit database testing.